Welcome, everyone. We've got a few people just trickling in at the end here, but we're going to get going on this super awesome webinar. I'm very, very excited. I'll give Yuri a quick introduction in a few, but in the meantime, I'm just going to do a quick little introductory slides here. So let me just pull all that up. Sorry, just a couple technical difficulties here. Here we go. There it is. Okay, so welcome to the, this is episode 5, if we can believe it, of the Strength Jedi Council webinar series. If you haven't met me before, I'm Scotty Butcher. I work at the University of Saskatchewan. Work at the University of Saskatchewan in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, Canada, and known as the Strength Jedi. So I'm just going to go through a couple beginning things here. So first off, I'm very excited to let everyone know that we have our May schedule up and running. So May is, we've got 5 presentations in May. The first one is one that I'm super excited for, mostly because it's on May the 4th be with you. And it's a good pal of mine, Shelley Prosco, is she's a yoga therapist, and she actually graduated the same year of physiotherapy school as I did. So we were classmates. And she's giving a talk on Yoda or yoga in rehabilitation. And then we've got a bunch more super exciting ones. I'm coming back. That's not that exciting, but then we have a related one to this one, which will also be really interesting. Eric Martinez is a registered clinical exercise physiologist, and he's going to talk about high-risk patients that actually can become high-performance patients that he's had. And then Laura Gian Gregorio from up here in Canada, she's a researcher that looks at osteoporosis and has developed a lot of the Canadian guidelines for exercise and osteoporosis. And then a physical therapist who specializes in pelvic health and female athleticism. So super exciting May. Bear with us if there's problems with the internet. If it cuts out, we'll be right back when I'll get everything up and going as quick as I can. So just chill and hang out. A couple of reminders here. We're going to keep our mics muted for the duration of Yuri's talk. When it's time for questions, what I'll do is I'll get you to either type your question in the chat and direct it directly to me so it just doesn't keep popping up and bothering Yuri. I'll moderate the questions. Or if you'd rather talk to ask your question, just write in the chat to me saying I have a question or me or, you know, something like that. And then I'll get to you in order for questions, but we'll hold those to the end. And then this is just a reminder that this is recording. So we are recording. And then once the webinar is over, then I will be posting it up on YouTube. So if you don't want your voice or image shown on and recorded, then don't speak up and don't show your mic and or your camera. All right, so here we are. I'm going to give Yuri a quick little introduction here, but he's going to give us a talk on incorporating high-intensity training in the exercise programs of individuals with chronic disease. Yuri and I have worked together quite a bit over the last few years for the purposes of research and a couple of review articles and in the high intensity functional realm and the CrossFit realm. And so I'm super excited to get Yuri on. So I'm just sharing my screen here. It's going to pop up and here we go with Yuri's intro. So there is Yuri. That's Yuri's quick little intro here. So I am going to, I hope you like that, Yuri.
Best intro ever.
Excellent. All right. Well, I'm just going to turn it over to you. I'm going to put you on speaker view. You can share your slides and yeah, the floor is yours.
Awesome. Scotty, thank you so much. I really appreciate that. That's, I have to say, I've given this talk a couple of times and that's the best introduction I've ever gotten. So I appreciate that. That's awesome. Yeah. So let me go ahead and share my screen here. Share the desktop. Wait a minute. Hold on. Give me 1 second. Just got to do a security check here real quick.
It doesn't seem to make a big difference how many times you do these. Everything just kind of pops up differently. So,
okay. All right, let's try to do that. And let's do this. Share. All right. Can you guys see that?
Yeah. It's your sort of introductory slide, but it's not the actual, it doesn't have the actual, screen. So I don't know if you were showing it just as, like just your, PowerPoint, but it doesn't have the actual, starting the presentation. There you
How's
go.
That?
Okay. Yep. Good All to right. go. Yep. Perfect.
Cool. Excellent. Well, thank you everybody for being there. Realize that, you know, these are tough times for everybody. So I'd certainly appreciate the opportunity to be here with you. As Scotty said, I'm an associate professor of exercise science at Kennesaw State University, and really want to talk to you guys a little bit about high intensity training. And obviously over the last several years, this training modality has, you know, sort of surged as one of the top modalities of training, and not only for athletes, which kind of has had the brunt of most of the studies and the literature, but you know, recently we started implementing it with some of the older populations and even disease populations, which is kind of where I want to spend a lot of my time tonight. First thing, obviously no conflict of interest here. All the information that's provided here is for educational purposes. So if you have any questions in regards to that, I'm happy to talk about it. So a little bit of the content of what I want to talk a little bit about. We'll talk a little bit about the history of high intensity interval training, extremely brief. We'll talk a little bit about the definition, just so everybody's sort of on the same playing field. We'll talk some of the benefits, some of the stuff that you guys already probably know. I'll spend some time on the safety, which I think is most important. And then, you know, kind of get to the meat and potatoes, if you will, of the program design and progression, and some thoughts for conclusion. I thought the last couple of points probably most important for those on the other side. So when we talk about high intensity interval training, we're really talking about a modality that, you know, it's not new, even though that, you know, the popular media makes it seem that is something that it's kind of the best thing since sliced bread and it just started yesterday. You know, high intensity training has been out since the 70s and even earlier, some reports, you know, specifically looking at athletes, as well as some of those first responders, individuals, so the individuals that perform that kind of high intensity work on a daily basis, and oftentimes you always think about athletes for performance, and those people whose job depend on physical performance. So that's kind of where high intensity interval training started, and it's kind of just done sort of a 360, if you will, and over the last probably, you know, 10 years or so. It sort of surfaced as to one of these top trends that we talk about on a regular basis. Since 2014, high intensity interval training has made the top 10, actually top five of these sort of trends that are the surveys that we look at from a trend standpoint among the population. So, you know, it's pretty common. Everybody sort of sees it. Everybody really talks about it in one way or the other. But how do we get this type of training to other people? Well, we look at the literature, though, however, that's kind of where the discrepancies happen. So if you look at what what the popular media tells us, you know, high intensity training is very common, very common, very common. But the reality is when you look at some of these, the, you know, publications that have looked at high intensity training in comparison to other more common measurements in the exercise physiology, physiotherapy component, you see that those numbers aren't there. So these are numbers in thousands, and you can see that, you know, towards the end of, you know, 2016 or so, you can see the discrepancy there between what we usually, you know, measurements that we usually talk about, lactate, VO2 max, in comparison to high intensity interval training. So there's a lot of opportunity there, especially with clinical populations. So anybody out there that is a student, current student, potential future student, you know, think about that as a way to getting into the literature, if you will, because there's a lot of questions that are still unanswered, especially with clinical populations. So in regards to definitions, you know, what we talk about HIIT, we always think of high intensity interval training, but you know, the basics of what HIIT is, you know, this principle of, you know, high intensity bouts with, you know, low intensity bouts, and they're separated by a specific period. We'll talk a little bit about that resting period when we talk about the programming, because it has significant impact in how you do the workouts, and how you present that workout to a client, a participant. And just for the purposes of of our discussion, I'll talk about client, participant, individual, and I really all mean the same, just the person that you're working with, just for generality. Obviously, we typically have a measuring tool or something that we look at, whether it's heart rate peak, VO2 peak, where, you know, those measurements, or something more, you know, kind of just individualized for the participant, for the individual here, just tells you how they feel. But this is what a session would look like, right? So you, and most of you guys are probably familiar with this or have worked in this area. You know, you talk about high intensity valleys and peaks, where it's moderate intensity is your sort of your base. And then you have these intervals that you do along the way. That's kind of obviously what we would consider high intensity interval training. You know, but the key to all of this really happens in, you know, where most people think the high intensity interval training should be is, you know, this sort of near maximum capacity, where we talk about, you know, percent of heart rate max of 90%, 96%, or near 100% of the capacity. But the reality is that if you look at this table, and depending on who your client is, any one of these intensities, whether it is, you know, 57% or 60% or VO2 max, could very well be considered high intensity for one particular individual. So I think, you know, when we start looking at designing these programs, you really have to know who you're working with and what those high, quote unquote, high intensity would be for that particular individual. It's my opinion, and some of the literature that I'll present tonight will support it, that, you know, anything, again, anything could be high intensity if you design it properly. So most people, when you think about high intensity, and everybody out there, when we talk about high intensity interval training, thinks that, you know, it has to be the hardest thing that they ever do at any point in time. And the reality is that it doesn't have to. You know, you don't have to carry those 500 pound weights up a, you know, 20% grade with a 30% mile an hour or 30 mile an hour speed. The idea is that anything that you're doing with your client, if you really know your client, or you're in the individual that you're working with, you should be able to give them enough load to have that intensity and really be able to get the stimulus that you want. So, you know, this kind of just want to put it here just because it's important, but most of you on the other side are probably aware of the benefits of high intensity interval training is, and typically as it compares with moderate intensity continuous training, and the modalities are not the same, but most of the research that's been done has compared the two, whether it's comparing volumes or time and that sort of thing. So, you know, any one of those fitness components. But the idea is that you're going to have significant benefits in high intensity training compared to moderate intensity continuous exercise. All right, so the question then becomes, is it only for athletes? And the short answer truly here is no, not at all. These are several studies I've actually looked at clinical populations and what are those benefits. And the most immediate really looks at the increases in VO2 peak or aerobic capacity. Obviously, there's going to have improvements in cardiovascular risk factors, blood pressure, HDL, cholesterol, triglycerides, fasting glucose, all of those risk factors that we talk about for cardiovascular disease. And then in some cases, even structural changes in the myocardial. So you have improvements in stroke volume, systolic and diastolic left ventricular function. So it's not only about improving aerobic capacity. There may be other benefits associated with the high intensity interval programs that we're prescribing that may or may not be visible to a participant. So I think where I spend some of the time really, and this is where some of my questions usually come up, is the safety of high intensity interval training. I'm going to kind of cover very briefly two studies that and sort of review studies to kind of give us an idea of what these protocols are and how effective or safe they may be for these individuals with clinical conditions, specifically cardiovascular disease, just because obviously heart disease is the number one killer in the U.S. as well as in other countries in around the world. I certainly believe Canada is one of those as well. And you know, it's really the number one killer in the world. So we sort of focus on cardiovascular disease a lot, but the same could be said for other chronic conditions. So in this study, this is a 2019 study really looking at high intensity interval trainings with heart disease patients, coronary artery disease patients. The most common protocol that they looked at was a 12-week regimen of 4x4 in duration and 85% to 95% heart rate max. And then this 3-minute recovery, which is going to come up later on as a way to sort of monitoring this intensity. So when we look at those results, we could really see that high intensity interval training, even though high intensity interval training and moderate intensity interval training resulted in positive benefits for both groups, both populations, we could see the difference is really for high intensity interval training seems to do better when we talk about aerobic capacity or VO2 max in comparison to high intensity interval training. There's several things here we'll talk a little bit about in a second as to why that would be the case, but there's some really good evidence to suggest that, you know, that improvement in VO2 max is not necessarily central, but is actually peripheral in nature. So yes, left ventricular function improves. Yes, heart rate improves, chronotropic response improves, stroke volume changes. However, it seems like the biggest change is happening at the muscle side, not necessarily in the central system. So if we look at safety, right, what I typically try to tell my students is that you always want to look at the worst case scenario. Who are the sickest of the sick in an environment like with cardiovascular disease? And in this case, heart transplant patients, I would imagine that would be considered the sort of the worst of the worst, if you will, in regards to, who, not necessarily of who they are, but what presents from a clinical standpoint and the sort of the carefulness and the risk that they provide. So in this study, looking at, again, 2019 study published in Circulation, looking at interval training and heart transplant patients. And really the results are fascinating to me as an exercise physiologist, because you could see there that everything changed regardless of the group that they were in, whether it's a high intensity group right there in the middle or in the moderate intensity and continuous training group. Exercise seems to be beneficial for heart transplant patients. But I'll take it a step further and kind of bring your eyes into this little box. The reality is that the high intensity interval training group improved the VO2 max percentage, the VO2 max in percentage points significantly more than the moderate intensity continuous group. So if the idea for heart transplant patients is to improve aerobic capacity and functional capacity, it may be that high intensity interval training may be better for these patients than continuous training. I had the opportunity to work with several heart transplant patients as a clinician, and I could tell you that, you know, the people that I worked with, a lot of the times they didn't have the energy, stamina to walk on the treadmill for 30 minutes. So if the goal really was to improve function, I can't get you to walk for 30 minutes. So what do? Well, we'll do some interval work. And that interval work may very well be, you know, sets of 30 seconds or 10 seconds, and progress that modality that way, until maybe we can get you to do that 30 minutes on your own. But certainly can't really start someone who hasn't been able to do anything for, you know, for 2 or 3 months. And also depends on how much time they spent in the transplant list, to walk on the treadmill and just walk for 30 minutes or even go off for a walk on their own. So, you know, again, individualizing that training modality, depending on who you're working with, is going to be paramount. And then mostly what I thought it was interesting in this study is that if you look at both the high intensity training group and the moderate intensity training group, again, peak heart rate didn't really, there was no difference between the two groups. Both groups did well and improve their aerobic capacity, which is excellent. Both groups ended up working at a higher percent max. But I sort of bring your attention down here to the muscular capacity component, where the muscular exercise capacity actually improved in the high intensity group significantly more than the moderate intensity group. And we could tie this back to, you know, the previous comment we talked about improvements in VO2 max as a result of peripheral changes. It seems that the muscle is really where what's driving these changes. And that's the thing that's where the biggest change and the biggest benefit for a buck, the little time that we spent with those participants, may very well be in those muscular changes and peripheral changes that are occurring. So is it safe in regards to rates? If you really want to get into incidence rates and how safe they are, we're looking at anywhere between, you know, one major cardiovascular event per 11,000 training hours, which, you know, in regards to what those are, obviously 11,000 hours is a lot. So is it safe? Yeah, it's safe. Is it without risk? No, absolutely not. But neither is walking out your door. So, you know, there's pros and cons to all this, type of training, just the same way that it would be with any other kind of training. So you kind of really have to understand who you're working with, where the participant is saying, what are their goals and what they want to do. So in summary, if you want to kind of just one slide to summarize all that we've said so far, you know, there's really no evidence that suggests that the risk of exercise outweighs the benefits when it regards to high intensity training. So you could implement it into your training program. You just kind of have to know who it is that you're working with and what are some of their goals and their limitations, of course. And when we talk about, you know, the comparison between moderate intensity continuous versus high intensity, you know, we could probably argue that there really isn't enough evidence to really say one is better than the other in the overall scheme of things. You know, show you some evidence there that VO2 seems to improve more in comparison to the moderate intensity group. But again, you know, you saw the numbers there of those studies, and it's a limited review. There was probably about 7 or 8 studies in that regard. So is it you know, zero risk? Absolutely not, but it's certainly something that we can do with our clients, with our participants. But here truly is the problem. The problem in the literature is, you know, if you're really interested in something like this and trying to learn a little bit more about the topic, this particular article is fascinating. It's a great review in Obesity Reviews of 2015. And really the problem becomes that when we start looking at all this data in aggregate, we can't really pinpoint a good protocol to suggest this is the best protocol that we have. You know, if you could see there, the numbers, you know, the intervals are all over the place. The recovery periods are all over the place. The total time, total volume of the programs are all over the place. The weeks, the how many times, how much time the individuals spent in each of the protocols. So it's hard to say that one protocol that works better than the other. And the real answer here is that you have to individualize this prescription. And I know that most of you on the other side of this screen are probably like, well, no, I mean, yeah, duh. But the popular media doesn't tell us that. The popular media really wants that one size fit all. And the reality is that that really doesn't exist. All right. So look, I'm doing with time. Okay. So when we talk about program design, this is really the fascinating piece for me is how do we get to incorporating this type of training with your clients, with the individuals, the chronic condition patients who by the way, are the ones that need it the most, right? Because your 30, 40-year-old, relatively fit cousin, really, you know, they could do whatever you want, but you really should be trying to impact, you know, the life of that, you know, mom or aunt or grandma that is primarily sedentary and is really just sitting at home and really doing nothing, especially during the times that we live in. So I'm more fascinated to, you know, how can we use this to really engage those individuals in regards to get them to exercise. And we know we have some really good evidence to suggest that high intensity training is not only good for the body, but it's also for the mind. And that's a totally different presentation altogether. Maybe we could do that in the future. But the reality of training here is that the HIIT requires that methodological design of a training program. It really is individualized training for all your clients, regardless of who they are. And we really, what I try to drive with my students, as well as anybody who cares to listen at this point, is that intensity, what we talk about intensity, is completely relative to the individual. So here are two individuals. One, it's an Olympic athlete. The other one is a heart disease patient that's in blue. The Olympic athlete, it's in red. And if you look on the left side of the axis, looking at your screen on the left side, you can see there's heart rates. Those are heart rate values of that particular individual. Obviously, the heart disease patient has significantly lower heart rate values in comparison to the Olympic athlete. You see those are 117, 124 for the heart patient. The Olympic athlete's 169, 179. Yet if you look at the right side of the screen, they're both working at the same relative load. They're both working at 90-95% of their maximal capacity. And that's important because this means that I could get my 85-year-old grandma, 75 or 65, whatever, and I could actually have her do exactly the same as this quote-unquote Olympic athlete with whatever modification they may require, but I could still do the same work. And that, again, it's important because the volume and the stimulus is going to be paramount in order to see those benefits. Granted, obviously the intensity is going to change, the resting potentially is going to change, you know, the modality itself is going to change, but they could still work at the same time and at the same intensity in comparisons from a relative standpoint. And I think if you're going to keep any slide of what we talk about here tonight, I think this is the slide that you would put in the back of your phone when you're training someone. This is the slide that you print and you put it out there and you really talk about it and try to explain it to your clients. And I've given you the reference in the top there. It's a 2017 study. This is not my graph, but I love this graph because it really truly puts in perspective what high intensity interval training is and how we could use it regardless of who we're working with. And obviously it's not the same. Well, not only is the intensity not the same, even though that it could be relative workloads could be the same, the program itself, it's not the same. You know, think about obviously we talk about high intensity interval training having peaks and valleys, right? But the peaks are going to matter and the valleys are going to matter sometimes even more, right? Because the recovery is where the really things happen. So if you have a session that is 2 minutes long, on the peak or the workload is 2 minutes long and your recovery is 1 minute, that's going to feel completely different if the peak of the workload is 1 minute long and the recovery is 1 minute long, or vice versa. If the peak is 1 minute and the recovery is 30 seconds, excuse me. And this is, you know, you guys do this on a regular basis, but the popular media fails to remember that the intervals matter, and not every high intensity interval program is the same. So, you know, you as the trainers, the clinicians, the individuals designing the programs, you know, you have to keep this in mind. There's more than just intensity when we're designing some of these programs, and we'll talk a little bit about that in a second. So we bring this to the, if we really try to get into the physiological aspect of it, this is how different types of high intensity training impact the body as a whole. So, you know, whether it's a sports demand, you've got to understand what the physiology is of the individual. And on the top, you know, this is more specific for athletes, if you will, but you can use exactly the same nomenclature for a clinical population. I'll bring your eyes directly to that circle in number five, because when you talk about high intensity or sprint interval training, high intensity interval training, where you have those peaks and valleys, that's works and rest component, something happens here that doesn't happen anywhere else in any of the programs that we talk about, whether we're talking about short intervals of 60 seconds, long intervals of more than 60, or this sort of repeated sprint training component. If you look at number five and you look at all six numbers there, you know, something happens in the sprint interval training, this sort of interval component that's specific to the periphery. And again, that peripheral O2, that peripheral saturation seems to drive that improve in aerobic capacity, regardless of what's happening in the central system. So whether you're having myocardial changes, left ventricle changes, stroke volume changes, you know, the periphery seems to be driving this sort of thought where high intensity interval training, sprint training, if you will. And I realize that the definitions may be different, but, you know, really driving the point here that the periphery, the change in muscle fiber is going to drive this change at the central level. So when we put it all together, really the idea here is looking at, you know, what's happening in the muscle. You know, when we talk about both central and peripheral adaptations, again, the activation of the type 2 muscle fibers, it seems like it's driving that component. We all know that as we get older, we kind of lose those type 2 muscle fibers, right? And the type 1 muscle fibers kind of take over. And it kind of makes sense because if you think about what is our daily activity, unless you're rushing to do something, most of us usually do our typical activity in a relatively moderate pace. And it's continuous in nature. So as you get older, where you become less anaerobic, if you will, you know, the type 2 muscle fibers, which is kind of where we train, that anaerobic metabolism component kind of just become dormant. I wouldn't say that they kind of go away. I guess we could totally have the argument that they just sort of go away and they don't come back. But some of the literature suggests that they do come back. They kind of just become dormant because we're not using them. So I think, you know, using this type of work with some of those individuals who need it the most is going to be most important, regardless of, you know, whether they decrease aerobic, you know, aerobic capacity or increase aerobic capacity, decrease blood pressure. So some of those major risk factors, I think focusing on the periphery is going to be important. And obviously increasing some of those muscle fibers is going to have some of that increased mitochondrial biogenesis and activation, which leads to those improvements in the anaerobic capacity. So from a programming standpoint, really, you know, kind of keeping it relatively basic, if you will, there are some contraindications that we have to be aware of, right? We talk about risks. So specifically looking at coronary artery disease patients, really looking at what is going on with that particular individual. If you have someone who has an unstable angina, heart failure, if they had a heart attack or bypass surgery, that's going to be important. And then any other pathology that may prevent some of these individuals from engaging in that type of work. Of course, this comes in the medical history component. So that's really relatively, you kind of just have to understand what it is that they have, you know, what are kind of conditions they're living with in order for you to be able to design the program. If you're not in a clinical environment where you have your own practice or you're a personal trainer or you have your own online training business or whatever the case may be, just really make sure that you have at least something set up that provides a, some level of medical awareness for yourself, whether it's a fancy health history questionnaire or something like a ParkU Plus, something like that, that gives you an understanding of who this person is, especially if it's a new client. That's going to be paramount. And I would recommend HIIT as a tool. I can sit here and tell you that it's the best thing since sliced bread. And the reality is that it does work. The reality is that it's, you know, it keeps people engaged, probably more so than continuous moderate training. We have some really good data out of our lab and others suggesting that high intensity training is more enjoyable than moderate intensity training for most people. It causes more discomfort during the exercise, but at the end of the exercise, people seem to enjoy the exercise session more than, you know, doing a continuous type of a program. And I'm sure that you guys feel the same way when you do your training. You rather kind of hit the weights for a couple of seconds and kind of just get the cardio in sort of spurs and then kind of walk out the door versus having to spend an hour and a half, 2 hours training, unless obviously that's part of your goal. But the reality is that most people don't have time, right? Not over the last 6 weeks, but it will be, it's one of those things where most people sort of cite lack of time as the biggest barrier to exercise. I always sort of kind of go back and forth on that one because we always, you know, most people tell us that they don't have time, yet some of the epidemiological data that we have access to, both through, you know, in the US and around the world, suggests that most people are watching TV anywhere between 3 to 6 hours a day. So, the recommendations ask you to do about 20 to 30 minutes every day. You tell me you don't have time, but you're willing to sit in front of the TV 3 hours and watch, you know, The Bachelor or whatever other show is out there. So I think there's more to it, right? It's more than just time. And I imagine you as clinicians, as practitioners have seen that in the past. And currently see it now with the whole, you know, our COVID situation. It will be really interesting, and I'm not sure if the data is available yet. I know that some data is available from Fitbit that our sort of levels of physical activity have decreased significantly over the last 6 weeks in the world, not just in the US or Canada, but in the world. And we're talking about large percentages. So, you know, think about everybody that was commuting to and from work. They're not doing that activity. I guarantee you, and I could be wrong, but the data shows otherwise, that, they're not doing extra workout to fit in those extra, you know, 10, 15, 20 minutes that they have to walk to and from the train or whatever the case may be. So, but I digress. Moving back to where we are here, I would say that high intensity interval training is a tool in your toolbox. You have to really understand who the person is, what their goals are. What do they do outside of your clinic? It kind of defeats the purpose if they see you twice a week and you try to do the best you can. You kind of give them 100% with your programming and you really develop this elaborate protocol and define design, and when they go home they just sit and they sit for the rest of the week and they don't see you again for the next 3 or 4 or 5 days. So how are you incorporating this into their training, not only in the rehab environment but also when they go home? Are they doing some walking on their own and really just increasing the pace, or how does that fit into your overall plan? That's going to be most important. That's really where HIIT becomes most effective. When we talk about high intensity interval training, we really talk about many components. There's 12 components, I should say, 12 variables related to programming that significantly impact how your individual, your client is going to perform. Yes, intensity is number one, but you can see there, how all of those components play along together. And overall, when you put it all together, and I think this is one of those images that you probably want to put on your wall somewhere as well, in addition to the relative intensity heart rate one that we saw earlier. I think when you put it all together for our clinical populations, for the people that we work with, number 9 is going to be the most important of them all. I don't care how intense the durations, I don't care how intense or how long the sessions are. If you're not modulating that volume, the total volume week to week or session to session, you're truly wasting your time. So really understanding how to modulate these 12 components. And I think component 11 and 12 are sort of on their side there, if you will, just from the standpoint of for athletes, but they are important for the people that you're working with as well. So if we want to kind of give you sort of a take home, take with you, do it at the clinic tomorrow, kind of a four-step process of how to incorporate these HIIT protocols with your participants. This is adapted from a paper by Taylor et al. Last year, and it's really looking at how to incorporate heart rate training with HIIT protocols. Again, any of these, by the way, any of those references that I've shared with you guys, if you're interested, I have them all. I'm happy to send PDFs of them. I'm happy to send you a link to where you can learn more. So, when this is all over, you reach out and I'll send you those articles if you like. But anyway, from a standpoint of how to design it, you really want to look at measurement of heart rate. And heart rate, it's important to look at, even though a lot of the times, depending on what you're doing, may not necessarily be the best marker of intensity. For example, we have some really good data coming out of a lab that if if you're doing a kind of like a CrossFit type workout, heart rate may not necessarily mean anything because there's so much, some workouts require so much upper body movement that, that's going to spike your heart rate, right? So chronotropically, that heart rate really means nothing. We often see some of the literature, some of the data that we're seeing is, heart rate's over here at sort of, 85, 90%, even somewhat 100%, yet VO2s, it remains constant throughout the session at, maybe 80, 85. So it's still, obviously there's a difference between heart rate response and VO2 response, but in this regard, when we're talking about just, high intensity intervals that you could do on a treadmill or a bike or something that doesn't have a lot of upper body involvement, if you will, you could definitely look at some of these two equations. So if you have beta blockers, that's BB is beta blockers, so cardiac medications, you could use the heart rate max formula, 211 minus 64% of your age. And if you have blood beta blockers on board or prescribed, you could use 164 minus 70% of your age. So whichever one you prefer to use, those that's up to you and depending on your participant. And then you design, once you have your heart rate max numbers, then you design what percent of max you want to work with. And then when the person actually does the exercise, that session, you ask them about the RPE. I presume everybody on the other side understands and knows the RPE scale. So you ask them, how do you feel? If they give you something less than 15, that particular intensity of that heart rate max intensity that you calculated may very well be too light. If it's over 18, then it's definitely too hard. So you really want that 15 to 18 sort of component to kind of give you an idea of sort of where they are. That's sort of the sweet spot, if you will, of incorporating that HIIT into that training. So kind of just something quick that you could take to the clinic basically tomorrow. All you have to do is sort of remember 211 minus 64% of your age if you have someone without beta blockers. And then these are other protocols. Remember, several slides back, we talked about there's really no consensus as to what kind of protocol is best for high intensity interval training. So here it kind of gives you sort of another table in regards to what you could do. And again, the most important variable that we can talk about and really spend some time on and really tracking and designing programming is this total volume number. Whether it's time, whether it's the combination of time, intensity, and rest components, that series number, total volume is going to be paramount for the progression of your training and of your client's training. So, if you want to keep the programming simple, if you want to keep what you're doing simple with your clients, not only for yourself, because obviously if you have multiple clients working at the same time, that's going to get complicated, but really for your participant. right? For the individual who you're working with. You know, if you really want to keep it simple, you give them an intensity and then use this rule of three. 3 minutes of active recovery. So they, you know, you put them on a treadmill or a bike or whatever the case, whatever the modality is, put them in the rowing machine, and then you give them 3 minutes of recovery after that session, that peak of intensity. So again, put them on a treadmill at 3 miles an hour, 3.5, 4 miles an hour, whatever the case, for 2 or 3 minutes, for 3 minutes of work. And then those 3 minutes of active recovery, depending on how they feel during that active recovery piece, that's going to tell you sort of if that intensity of that work intensity is too light or too high. If the 3 minutes were not enough to recover for the individual, then that previous intensity is too strong, too long, too high. If the 3 minutes was too long and they're sort of itching to get back, you know, those 3 minutes of recovery, then that intensity may be too low. So you kind of have to work a little bit of with your participant and ask them what they want and how they feel in order to have a better program in you know, and really get to where that participant wants to be. And then, you know, finally, you know, really looking at what the training is, we, you know, we're talking about, you know, less than 20% really. One in every five adults in the U.S. specifically are meeting the 2018 physical activity guidelines. And that's, again, as most of you already know, 150 minutes of moderate intensity most days of the week, or 75 minutes of vigorous intensity most days of the week for most people. For most those individuals with clinical conditions, probably less than that 20% are actually getting to those numbers. You know, but we see that high intensity interval training, not only is it beneficial from a cardiovascular standpoint and a risk factor standpoint, but there's also some, you know, sort of mental component that again may be a little bit more enjoyable than moderate intensity exercise overall, which ultimately, if, you know, as we always say, if they like it, they'll do it. So why not give them something that they enjoy, something that they like, in order to get to what they want to do. And then ultimately, I think lastly, and I think most of you on the other side understand this and really take it to heart, because that's the reason why you're here. An effective program really requires careful planning and a personalized approach. You can't just do the same programming for everybody. You can't just do the same things that you do with Heather, that you do with Joe. You know, it has to be different, not only the mode, the intensity, the breaks, the peaks, the series, everything has to be individualized if you really want to have significant improvements with your clients. So with that, that's my email address. You can find me on LinkedIn. You can find me on Twitter. I don't do a lot of work on Instagram. I'm trying to do better, but I actually enjoy the brevity of Twitter a little bit more than both Facebook and Instagram. So I hope you enjoyed it. Try to keep it to the audience and try to make it as practical as it possibly can for you every day. So I hope that it was enjoyable, and I'll take any questions.
Yuri, that was absolutely fantastic. Thank you so much for an engaging presentation. What a nice overview of some of the current literature, and brought a very practical component to your programming in that. So that was awesome. I'm going to get you to stop sharing your screen so that we can kind of have our viewpoint of everybody up there. Perfect. There you go. Awesome. So, there's a couple questions on the group chat, but I'm going to start off with a couple questions of my own, just to give other people a chance. If you're thinking of some questions, just gives you a chance to type them out. Remember, you can also just say, I have a question, or say, type me, and I'll come to you in order, and you can turn on your mic and ask them. But, like I said, I love the presentation, Yuri. And it's, as you know, it's an area that's near and dear to my heart. Mm-hmm. That I've published in COPD patients with right. In terms of interval work and that, and so that's sort of where my background started with my PhD, my research as a faculty member. It's just on the note of COPD, it's really interesting. So on the Katie Weston review, they list severe COPD as a contraindication, but those are the guys that need it the most, I think.
Right, absolutely, 100%.
Yeah, they, I mean, it's like you said, it's just their day, you know, their daily lives are just so hard, you know, trying to get them to do even a little bit of exercise. The interval is actually something that's, that is absolutely needed, because just going for a walk across the room mm-hmm. is high intensity for them. So taking breaks is crucial. Would you agree?
Yeah, absolutely. And not only that, again, I think where we're learning the most about, you know, high intensity interval training and what's happening in the muscle, it's actually through these pulmonary patients, because we know that they don't have the diffusion in the lung capacity, right? So it can't be in the lung that's working, because, you know, they have improvements in aerobic capacity, even though their ability to diffuse that oxygen is limited through their, you know, their condition. So, you know, that truly that population and the work that you've done has really driven sort of that under better understanding of the components of the periphery and how that impacts improvements in overall capacity. And when we talk about capacity, not necessarily just VO2 max, but just in general. And I would agree 100%. If you have, you don't know the benefits of high intensity interval training or high intensity training works until you work with a pulmonary patient, that changes your perspective. It really does.
Absolutely. I agree with that 100%. And I mean, we're, you know, patting each other on the back here, which is good. yeah, it's
well, but the data shows it, right?
Yeah, absolutely. That's what the data shows. And it's interesting that it's only been the last few years that's kind of come up, but mm-hmm. good. So I just had just a couple things. So in I really love your recovery slide, the simple programming for recovery, where you base it on the 3 minutes. And if it's too, a little bit too, they're not quite recovered enough, you go a little bit longer. If it was a little bit too easy and they can, in terms of that last interval that they were managing that really, really easily, mm-hmm. that you might decrease the recovery time. Do you ever objectify that? Do you try and do RPEs or something like that for recovery, or do you just do it based on what they're telling you?
Yeah, I mean, I think if you, you know, I love the RPE scale, but as practitioners, we all know that, you know, patients have a memory for the RPE scale, right? So when they always give you a number, and they know that if they give you a lower number, you're either going to increase their intensity or they're going to lower their intensity, you know, you kind of have to play this game of sort of where they are. So I think if you really need a measurement, you could definitely do the RPE scale as a recovery measurement, and kind of see where they are. And you can see where, you know, they started at, you know, you had that peak, the work session, at, you know, they ended at a 15, and then the first minute after the recovery started, the first minute they went down to a 14, and then went to a 13 and a 12. And then once you got to the 12, then you brought them back, to that 15 session. So, I mean, I think you could do that. I've never done it. I don't have the evidence to show that it works or it doesn't. But from a practical standpoint, I'm afraid that after a while, the patients get used to, like, oh, well, if I tell them that I'm at a 12, then I'm going to go back to 15 or 16. Yeah. Yeah. So then I was, oh, I'm at a 13. Oh, I'm at a 13 for another minute. And then this recovery period becomes, you know, longer than your work period. And that kind of defeats the purpose. So I think if there needs to be an objective measure, I think RPE is definitely good, but we have to understand that it obviously has limitations in that regard.
Yeah. Yeah. Good. I wouldn't necessarily suggest to use the RPE. I think I do think that just more subjective measures of sure. know, just how they're feeling, I think make a lot of sense. Yeah.
Absolutely.
You know, I certainly wouldn't use, I know people will use, you know, in this literature, they'll use things like, you know, has heart rate come down, has ventilation come down, VO2 come mm-hmm. down. And I've always shied away from those, knowing the disconnect between potentially what you're seeing there and what the capabilities of the client are going to be. Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So my last question, then I'm going to get to the questions from the crew. So most of the evidence that you've looked at, and certainly most that's out there, is based on what we would kind of call a moderate to high intensity interval, but it's more on the aerobic side. So it, mm-hmm. it's based on slightly longer intervals with 1:1, 1:2 work to rest ratio, kind of hitting the aerobic power, aerobic VO2 max type system. because there are other types of HIIT, as I know you know.
Sure.
You know, just as everybody else, just in case for everybody else, but they're like sprint intervals. So you talked about sprint intervals where you might actually go at a pace that's faster than VO2 max, you know, where that becomes, as you say, heart rate being less of an issue. I mean, I certainly have done that clinically, and part of my research has tried to push into that zone. And I've had recent good results, but that's just in COPD. And I don't know if you're aware of a lot of other stuff out there in other clinical populations. And I'm certainly, when I say, you know, like short interval, long recovery time. So we're, you know, we might be talking 20 seconds on, but then you might have a good 2 to 3 minutes off. Versus the Tabata, right? You wouldn't want to do
right.
You know, like 20 seconds on yeah. and then have like a 10 second
right.
off. So anyway, what I'm interested in is, are you aware of any recent research in clinical populations that's kind of tried to push the intensity a bit, but kept the duration really short, like going into the sprint interval type concept?
Yeah, I mean, I think with, you know, with the clinical population, I'm not familiar. I don't want to say that it doesn't exist. I'm sure, you know, somebody's done something out there. I'm not familiar with it. I think the biggest issue there becomes a potential for a adverse event, right? We talk about whether it is, you know, again, aerobic, cardiac patient, diabetic patient, pulmonary patient, you know, especially if you're looking at resistance training, right? What's happening to the blood pressure response immediately after that 20 second bout of, you know, maximal capacity, right? And we have some really good evidence to suggest that it's relatively safe with most people, but with some of these individuals with chronic conditions, I think we're a little bit more cautious. And I think it's hard to do because the IRB may not necessarily let you, right, in some areas. And, you know, obviously you have a lot more experience with that pulmonary population. So, but I mean, there is some evidence, but I think for the most part, people go more for the longer time intervals just to avoid some of those potential adverse effects with a very short, near maximum or super maximal intensity. So I would have to go back and look at something very specific that might be in the literature, but, you know, to the best of my knowledge, I don't really recall anything in that regard.
Yeah, no, it is an interesting question. Well, it is to me because I brought it up.
No, absolutely. Absolutely. I think you're absolutely right. We just don't know enough because the studies really, you know, it's really hard to do, you know, to know that, you know, you have a near maximum effort on whether it's a deadlift or power clean or whatever the case. And then, you know, you're talking about a lot of technique. You're talking about a lot of things that may impede that person's ability to just be able to do that particular exercise. So, I think that maybe we should do the study.
We should. We should talk about it for sure. It's interesting. There are in healthy people, older adults, they're starting to get into these very short, like 6 second intervals, sure. and they're doing it on a bike and stuff. I'm intrigued by that because if you do that and give enough recovery time, I mean, there's virtually no metabolic stress other than to the neuromuscular system. And to, you know, if you could argue the anaerobic, alactic, ADP, PCR mm-hmm. system, but which isn't really the challenge with most chronic disease, it's more mm-hmm. on the aerobic side. So anyway, intrigued by that.
Yeah, okay, definitely.
So I'm going to move on. So I have a question with question here. Let me ask it and then you'll see. So this participant wants to know what is the optimal interval to rest scheme that might be best for cardiac populations? Do you have a sense based on the literature, like what either is used the most or might be best for adaptation? Any thoughts?
Yeah. So there's one slide that I presented where it looked at the one slide looking at that Quindry and article in 2019. You know, the most common protocol, it was a 12-week regimen with work interval ratios of 4x4 minutes in duration at an intensity of 85% to 95% heart rate max, mm-hmm. And then 3 minutes of recovery. So, you know, you kind of have this one-to-one ratio, if you will, as to what that is. But again, you know, I show you that slide telling you that this is the most common, but in the following slide, I showed you that the problem was that the literature is all over the place, right? So I'm in some ways contradicting myself. I don't think that, I don't think that you really want to look at, you know, what is the most common protocol. I would say, what does your participant enjoy to do? That's the protocol that you want to do. That's the sort of, you know, we always talk about exercise prescription as a science and as an art. The science is there. You have to bring the art to that. You're the artist in that regard. So what is your client telling you? What is it that they're, you know, kind of going through? Because today's workout, it's complete, could very well be completely different than tomorrow's workout because they don't feel like it. They just, you know, something happened or, you know, stresses of everyday life. So I think I'm not sure that we could really look at what is the best, let's just say, which is the one that your client is willing to do.
Yeah, it's agreed completely. I love the saying, the best exercise is the one that the client will consistently do.
And yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, definitely live by
that. And it's true.
Yeah. So Carolyn had, when you were talking, she had a comment about, you know, the lung is not likely to change, but the periphery can, which I think then you followed up with to say that, you know, as we were talking. So the in terms of the peripheral type change, do you feel that it's the high, that 90-100% that kind of gets at that periphery? I know you mentioned that in one of your slides. Do you feel that kind of optimizes it in terms of peripheral adaptation?
I don't know that we can really say that, you know, 90% is better than 85 or 80%. You know, really is, you know, where do you start, right? Because if you're starting here, you know, if let's say that you're, let's just say that aerobic capacity is 60%, and that's kind of where you're at, giving you an interval that it's a 65 or 70% may be beneficial. And you may be able to maintain that intensity for, you know, 30 seconds, 1 minute. But if I put you an intensity of 90%, you're not able to sustain that. So I think it's, you have to sort of titrate it the same way that you would titrate a medication, right? Start slow, kind of see where that person is, and then progress it that way. I don't think that, you know, the peripheral change really happens between 60 and 90. I think the peripheral change just happens over time as you continue to modulate that load.
Awesome. Yeah, no, that's great. I have one last question from Melinda. She's asking in terms of exercise selection. So, you know, using more of a high intensity functional type interval training method, are there recommendations for what order to put them in? So she gives the example, if you had deadlift, med ball slam, and some sort of a carry, what order do you put them in? Or does it matter, you know, as long as they reach your measure that you set for the session?
Yeah, I think you have to think about what is the stimulus of that session. Is the stimulus weight? Is it time? Is it speed? You know, because every session is going to be different. You know, we could talk about those three movements in three different ways at the end of the day, right? You could have a deadlift that it's relatively fast. I don't want to say that it's fast because there's obviously technique issues there, but it's relatively fast, and that may very well be your rest time. And your med ball slams are sort of the big stimulus that you want to do because you want them to go relatively heavier. So I don't know that there's a best way to design them. Just think about what is the overall stimulus of the session. What do you want them to do and how do you want them to get there? You know, they're going to have to rest, obviously. So whether you want to incorporate that rest in that interval piece or do you want them to do the round, rest and then do the round again. Again, that's where, you know, that art piece comes about as to how do you want that workout to be and what do you want the stimulus to be? And that's really individualized to everybody. It's in your gym, right? If you have somebody who has a back injury, maybe you tell them, well, I want you to slow down on the deadlift or lower the weight on that deadlift, but speed up on a thruster exercise or a upper body exercise, you know? So again, that it's hard for me to say a definite, this is the way you should do it because there's so many other components that go into designing that.
That's a fantastic answer, Yuri. I agree completely with that. Just for the you know, I don't want to hijack what you're saying, because I agree with that. What some of the research that I've done on the on looking at multimodal HIIT, we designed a protocol that was sort of designed to get at both the strength and then the anaerobic components to it, and so using deadlift as your strength movement, you want to make sure, which is what the type of protocol that we did. If that's the goal, you want to make sure that's probably the first, right? Because if you're going to be loading that fairly heavily, you want to come off of a fairly long recovery period, and where you might have a good 3 to 4 minutes of recovery, like actual passive recovery or just light walking or something, prior to actually doing your heavy set of deadlifts. And then you can program in the other stuff later on. And that's sort of how we've structured it in the few studies that I've published on multimodal HIIT. But as you say, Yuri, that's assuming that the deadlift is the main stimulus for strength.
Right.
It totally makes a difference depending on what you're trying to do, for sure.
Right.
Yeah. Definitely. Good. Okay. Well, I think that's all the questions that are listed here, and that's everything that I had. Yuri, this has been fantastic, man. It's been really great talking to you, and I really enjoyed your presentation. So thank you so much for coming on and giving us your wisdom.
No, absolutely. Thanks for the opportunity. I appreciate everybody being there. Hopefully it was enjoyable and informative, if nothing else. So definitely appreciate the opportunity, and we'll be in touch.
Yeah, absolutely. All right. Thanks again, Yuri. Awesome. Thanks everyone else for being on the call. And I'll be posting this up in the next day or so. So, all right. Take care.
Great.
Thanks.
Thank you, Scotty.
All right. Bye.
Bye.